I do training in Kochi, training primarily in three areas, PMI-ACT. I'm assuming you guys know about that. PMI-ACT training, class training, certified system developer is the other course I do. It's about XP practices like customer development, developer development, CI, and all that stuff. I also do Lean Karma certifications from Lean Karma University, LKU. Before just training and pushing while I'm at 15 years of software development, company starting from DC, different roles, system master has been, I think, one of the most challenging roles. Scrum master for distributed team. Many of you must have, distributed team is a reality these days, right? And the change and motivation, both parts become more complex for distributed teams. Different team settings, when you're on-site coordinator, Scrum master, all this stuff. Experimenting with Agile 2006 onwards, or my proper formal introduction to Agile started in 2015. The Deutsche Bank company was embracing agility and they were transitioning to Scrum and Agile. And I have a bunch of
What's AKT?
AKT is accredited Kalman Freeman. That helps me do these certifications. AKT is Kanban Management Professional. AKT is a trainer. So as an AKT, I can give training on Kanban. So I can train people on KMP and TKP also. So KMP is a two-day certification, two-day certifications, and TKP is a one-day Kanban certification. Okay. Let's come to the topic now. Alright. Now I will not ask you to share this thing. This might be very personal thing for you, right? If you can, please write quickly up to three challenging situations you have had recently dealing with people. It could be your workspace, it could be your personal relationships, like the shopping issue the past weekend or something like that, right? Where you had some struggle, challenges with dealing with people. Right? I will not ask you to share with me or anybody else. Or I should say, unless most people, I would ask you if you want. Good? I give half a minute more. Looking at these same scenarios in a different way or not. That's not like that. Let's move on. So human potential, right? We almost rule this planet, right? Humans. Our potential is in unlimited, we almost rule the planet, but that does not mean that we can control other people easily, right? As humans, we control the planet, but we do not necessarily can easily control other people. There is a theory, it is from 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Stephen Covey, you might have heard about that book, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. So it says that a person, he or she has some things in their direct control. So that's our control sphere or control circle, you can say. And beyond the control, the second circle is about influence. Right? Things that you can influence. What is the difference between control and influence? Control is it directly in your control. Influence is somebody else will do it, but you have a relationship or you have the access to the person to have have a discussion with that person or try to convince that person to do that thing for you. Right? The third circle outside that is a circle of concern. Right? So it is in your wish list. You want that thing to happen. But you are not even in touch with somebody who can influence. Let's take it. Let's take some examples. Will it rain tomorrow or not? Which circle do you think that will lie? Control, influence, or concern?
Concern,
right? You're concerned about it, but you can't really do much about it. Will my child get admission in XYZ school? Means any school. Any particular school.
Concern,
influence, or control?
Concern.
Few things might be in your control, but ultimate decision is not in your control. So you can try to influence through reason or through educating a child, preparing the child for test or whatever, or through money, right? That's the reality. So through different reasons you can try to influence that thing. If you don't have money, maybe it might be just a concern. Will our company report more than 25% increase in revenues?
Control.
Control? As an individual, as an employee of that company, is it control, influence, or?
Influence.
As an individual, can you influence that 25% revenue in your entire company?
No.
As an individual?
It depends on the size of company.
Depends on the role.
That's a very good point. It depends on the role. But the leaf level or the lower level guys, maybe will not have that much of, you know, control. So for most of the people, it might be just a concern thing. You want your company to report higher sales, higher revenues, because it will mean something for you, right? Next one, will we release the product on its scheduled date? What about this? Think of a Scrum team or a Agile team, and you have to release something on a particular date, right? You want to try to control that. As a part of, as a team member, you try to, you know, take control of that. Maybe as an Agile coach, it's more of an influence thing, but as a team member, you try to bring that in your control. You sometimes stay late in the office, you know, try to do as much as possible and make sure it is in your control.
For the management, it's a
always. But they actually want to control that, right? Will I get promotion this year?
Influence.
Will I get promotion? Is that concern?
Influence.
Is it influence or
control?
Influence?
Yeah.
Why
not
control?
Ultimately, it's a decision made by somebody else.
Absolutely. So you can try all you can. You can do try to good performance and make an impression and this and that. But ultimately, the decision lies in somebody else's hand. So that's the basic, you know, rule that if the decision is going to be made by somebody else, it is mainly an influence thing. If you're in touch with that person, try to, you know, do something so the person can make that decision in your favor. Will he or she like me enough to want to marry me?
Initially, it's control. To start with, it's control.
Control?
To start with.
Really? So it also depends on whether it's one-sided or there's some relationship or not, right? But you got the idea, correct? So that's one theory. The question is, why depend on others? Why not do it all by yourself, the superwoman, right? Or the superman? Do it all by yourself. Why you depend on other people? Because when something is in your sphere of influence, you have to get it done through somebody else. You try to influence that person. That's not reality. It's very difficult. We have, as individuals, we have to interdepend on each other, right? In a relationship also, and also in the form of organization. Think of any organization. You are from PCS. Which company are you from?
Organization.
How many employees do they have?
2 lakhs.
2 lakhs, right? 3 lakhs?
3.5.
3.5?
Plus growing.
So if you want to have these many people, you want to have some structure, you want to influence those people, you have to depend on those people, right? So it is an economic reality. But how to control, influence others when they are in hundreds of thousands. So that's the challenge for organizations. And that's where, that's the second theory. Theory X and theory Y. So theory X is, it started in the manufacturing era, you can say, 1800s, 90, early 1900s and all, where people were easily replaceable, right? And the focus was the primary, the philosophy is that people left to themselves will not work. They do not want to work. So what do you do? You try to push them. You try to control. So that is theory X. It has been in vogue for a long, long time. and the focus is on higher productivity, right? Again, manufacturing example is the classic example. It encourages authoritarian style of management. Now, these days, you know, for a long time, they've been talking about theory Y also. So theory Y talks about evolution of people management. It says people, it assumes that people are internally motivated to work. It takes a different approach. Right? It says that people seek and accept responsibility. They enjoy working with greater responsibility. The focus is on productive work environment, creating an environment where people take responsibility. And you can probably correlate agile with this one more, right? And even in management, they have been talking about with the theory X should be replaced by theory Y. They have been talking about it for decades. But you still see some command and control culture in almost all organizations. So thinking simply, wherever there's knowledge work involved, people are doing some sort of creative work, innovation is involved, it's good to create an environment where people can rise up to the challenge and contribute to the entire company. Right? It's a participative style of management. So that's a question for you. Theory X still used these days? Which industries?
Almost every.
For manufacturing, definitely it is used because people are replaceable. Theory X could be, but they have to still depend on you. If they send a unit on the border or something, right? They have to create, so they have discipline, but discipline does not mean necessarily that they are forcing you towards theory X. I still assume that you will take responsibility. Okay. What about your, can you give me some examples? Do you see traces of theory X in your organizations? Yes? Yes.
Topmost management.
Can you give an example?
At home.
Housekeeping.
At home. The real emotions are coming. The side effects of theory X for knowledge workers. So ideally, theory X should not be applied for knowledge work. But theory Y should be used, but theory X we see some traces of that, right? The interesting thing is, when you apply theory X, when the management follows theory X, it ends up creating theory X employees. When management believes in theory Y, they end up creating theory Y employees. So we saw some example about Zappos and others, Pathagat was sharing some examples, right? And same thing you could see in knowledge work also in IT industry also. When the management, the manager behaves in theory X style, if he believes that the people will not work, left to themselves, so I have to micromanage, make sure this guy is working. He'll keep coming to your desk and keep asking, are you done yet? All the stuff, right? What happens in that case? Employees react in theory X way. The day you are not there, they will not work. Right? So that's the important thing. So if the management believes in a particular theory, it ends up treating those kind of employees. So it's a mindset shift, it requires that. Let's move on. That's the third theory. Anybody heard about Maslow's need hierarchy?
Yes.
Right? It's a very common thing. So, five levels, I'll quickly just go through them. You may or may not need to read the stuff on the right. So, basic is the physiological level, the basic level. The animalistic needs, you can say, the basic survival needs. Second is safety. When you start thinking ahead, start planning a little bit longer, right? Third is love and belonging. Family relationship, friend circle, social support. The fourth one is esteem and recognition. And the fifth one is self-actualization. When Maslow created this hierarchy of needs, he talked about two things which people objected later, other psychologists objected later. One was, he said, each individual moves through this hierarchy in this fashion. They start with this need, and when this is met, they move on to the next one, and next one. And other psychologists, they sort of contend in that, and the classic example is artists, right? In each culture, you can find examples of those artists who, right after maybe basic needs were met, they mainly focused on self-actualization, doing the best they can in their field. They lived in rushed conditions, they probably did not marry, right? They were just focused on doing the best in the field. So that's one objection. The other thing is, Maslow said, at any particular time, one of these needs is primarily active in individuals. And again, other psychologists say that it may happen that multiple needs could be active at a given point. Right? Any questions? It's very
Sanjay,
simplistic. Yes.
I have a question on theory X and theory Y.
Yes.
When we do our daily scrum meetings, where we are actually trying to figure out who did what and what was the roadblock, it is actually trying to implement theory X there, right? I mean, as a team, we are trying to figure out is that, okay, have you made any progress from yesterday? If not, let's solve for it after the meeting all of offline. But as part of your daily scrum meeting, we're actually trying to put theory X in an extreme way, because everybody is pushing everybody, what's not done yesterday, any of the roadblocks, right? We're not actually doing theory Y. We're saying that here's the task, let's meet at the end of the week, hopefully we'll all get up. We're saying every day, what has been done yesterday? Isn't it a theory X implementation in Scrum?
What is the motivation? See, if you think about daily Scrum, is it one person, how are you conducting a defense? Is it Scrum Master saying, all right, you tell me what did you do? Is it like that, or just Scrum Master stays in a corner and he lets people come step forward and share their status, right?
I mean, so the way I'm interpreting is that, as a team, we are asking everybody, not Scrum Master, the team we are figuring out who did what started. That's the extreme implementation of theory X. Rather than one person, everybody is questioning everybody. In the theory X, one person questions everybody, what was yesterday. And now, as part of our Scrum meetings, the whole team is trying to understand who did what yesterday. So it's the extreme implementation of theory X, right?
I would contend that.
Scrum Master only facilitates, right? He's, I mean, the Scrum Master is not even enforced.
Theory X does not empower people. Theory Y tries to empower people. If the daily scrum is being conducted in a way where one person is asking status and everybody is looking at this person, be it a manager, a young project manager, scrum master, whatever you call this guy, then it is, you see traces of theory X. If it is people stepping forward in front of the board and talking to the team, you have actually created an environment where people have been empowered. Then it is theory Y, not necessarily theory X. So in other words, what you can say is, whether the management is following theory X or theory Y will impact how you conduct your sessions.
Could it also be possible, just
probably
you could have just
I think the important thing about theory X, theory Y, how is the people who are in authority, how they are reacting, how are they taking decisions? That is the important thing, right? Whether your Scrum, and your point is valid, in Agile and Scrum also, many of the things that fail, it is because the people are still behaving in the old style, command and control culture, right? And the other thing could also happen in Waterfall also, if you have a manager who tries to empower people, that could still happen. So it's more about what is the underlying belief in the leader's mind? How are they interacting with the team? That is the thing.
I think he's made a valid point, and you're right that it's a psychology that we've inherited. So although we're in an agile environment, when everyone stands up, they feel a competitive urge to be answerable and known. And even the managers tend to judge on an individual performance. If we actually take agile, the people should be getting up and talking about what they did as a team. In that case, that takes the pressure off entirely. If they talk about that, okay, these were the tasks and as a team we resolved them, or in pair programming we resolved them, or we did this, it takes the whole pressure or theory X out of the game.
Absolutely. So again, it depends on whoever is the person in charge, Scrum Master, how is he conducting all this ceremony, what kind of environment is this person creating? Is he still using the philosophy of command and control and making people answerable to him? Or is it creating a culture where people are self-managing stuff, right?
depends on how it is being conducted.
You can also attach this to the next slide you have. The team is operating from the safety level. They did not go beyond that. That's why people feel that we are threatened when people question us. So it can be also the part of the culture of the team, where they think, even if everybody is questioning me, I think it's a good idea. Team is taking more ownership.
So questioning, and so again, there are different ways. So it might go into the other direction, that when people raise objections, what is their tone? Is it a blaming tone? Is it questioning? Is it challenging? What kind of thing? Right? And that's a whole different maturity thing about agile things. So let's move on. What time did it start? We have time, right? 40 minutes. Good. So how could you use this thing? So organizations use it a little bit. For example, they give you basic salary, right? That takes care of physiological needs. At least in IT, we can assume that the salary you're getting is taking care of your basic physiological needs. And they also, of course, take care of some of the safety. And many companies, they run programs like getting your loan at a lower rate, right? For housing loan and all this stuff. They are probably trying to satisfy this thing. Love and belonging, by creating, and it's not always love means that man-woman love kind of thing. It's more about having a social structure, right? If you create a structure where people, you know, want each other, not just think about tasks, but also think each other as individuals. You know, most of the companies, I'm sure, they run some sort of events, whether it's a Diwali event or New Year event and all that stuff. So they're trying to take care of this thing also. And as team is, we talked about title, right? Title is one, and their responsibility is also other thing. Let's move on. Flow. Anybody heard about this guy? Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. Csikszentmihalyi. It's a Czechoslovakian guy or somebody. A very respected psychologist. Mihaly is respected. So the thing is, if you look at this one, even though the company is going to stress or address some of the things, they are not always active in a person's mind when the person is working. This is all about motivation, right? What gives a person motivation? Once you have given this guy a loan, housing loan, that does not mean that this girl is going to be supercharged, motivated for the rest of the year, right? So you're taking care of basic stuff, but it will not ensure that each person is motivated, individual at all times. This theory, the flow, it talks about what keeps people motivated and engaged throughout the time. So what this guy did, he did an experiment, deeper study, and his objective was something else, but he found out something else. So the study was for teenagers, and he took up a sample where teenagers were supposed to be a little unhappy group in some society. So the task was some set of teenagers, 25 to 50 teenagers, they were given beepers. And these beepers would go off at different times. I'm doing something, suddenly the beeper goes off in my pocket. I'm supposed to take out a pen and paper and write what was I doing at that time. How was I feeling? What was the entire experience and all this stuff? Just my thoughts about what I was doing, how I was feeling. So he did that for some time over certain population of teenagers, and he figured out the people were really engaged, involved, when they were at some point, when they were doing something that really, he called it the state of flow. And I'm sure most of you might have experienced that state, right? Where you are doing something and you are just loving it. It could be writing up the best piece of software, or it could be maybe playing some sports, it could be playing some music or something else. You're doing something and you're really into that moment, really in that flow. You're performing, sort of, and you feel a state of euphoria inside you. Has it happened to you? Anyone? Everyone? Right? And now then, it could be happening when you're solving a problem, slightly complicated problem. So the second thing was, he defined the ingredients of flow. When could that flow-like state happen? So there are three ingredients. Number one is challenge. The task that you're doing, it should offer you some challenge. It should not be a very simplistic task. Right? So challenge is one. The second one is competency. You should have some competency. If you're try to play music, which is challenging, but if you do not have competency, it will lead to frustration. Good? Does it make sense?
Yes.
Challenge plus competency. The third is interest and passion. It should be along the lines of your interest and passion. You can play music, but you are done with it, you don't enjoy it anymore. You may not experience it too. Even if you can play good music, so the challenge is there, competency is there, but the passion may not be there. So these three are important ingredients, and that can really, let me ask you guys, do you feel this theory you could apply in your work life, or maybe managing people, or maybe for creating an environment where people challenge you? Challenge?
Theoretically, yes.
Theoretically, yes.
Also, the people, if you need to know so much more about them, understand their life.
So it might be difficult to create your tune for each individual, but for example, the way Agile does, right? One thing Agile does differently from Waterfall is by changing that structure of command and control to a self-managed culture. I usually draw this diagram. In Waterfall or command and control, what happens, manager is at the center, right? And everybody else is connected to this guy. It's like a star kind of network. A needs to talk, A needs something from B, go to the manager. You say, if you need something, come to me, I'll tell you if I need to talk to somebody or not, and all this stuff. Extreme command and control culture. And I've seen really ugly traces of this command and control. The people, the manager does not let people talk to each other. He wants to hold all the information, the power with himself. The transition, Agile transition, what they say is if there are six people here, they should be all allowed to talk to each other. I might have missed some, right? What about manager? Where did manager go?
Somewhere outside.
Yes. You can call it manager or scrum master, whatever, right? So he facilitates in creating an environment where people can talk to each other, they're self-managed, but he still needs to keep your pulse on what is going on, right? That's supposed to be the transition. And this probably, to some extent, is along the lines of, the flow can happen only when you create an environment where people are empowered, they are engaged in the process, right?
So Sanjay, actually,
yep.
This thing has been designed, when someone designed a game, they actually design in such a way, like, say, incrementally they increase the challenge, like say Angry Bird game.
Okay.
So I observe a couple of my friends' kids when they play, I ask them, why do you play? So they had interest to get more points.
Absolutely, most of the video games
exactly the same concept.
Follow this particular thing.
So
the initial steps are very easy. That's really, they get you hooked,
yeah.
Right? And then they have different levels, so it keeps the challenge with you. Otherwise, you just play it once and then leave it. Very good example.
They say they never feel bored. They keep playing until I feel that, okay, I win, and they will get the social recognition also that I have won the game. Yeah.
Absolutely.
And during ranking time to time, then so that you are at 20.
Right. That's good. Yeah.
That's a very interesting example of the same thing. Good? So perfect organization alignment. In an organization where you have perfect alignment, related to organization structure, culture, work environment, and profitability, right? But that may not always happen. So you must start with, at some point you want to reach perfect alignment along all these things, right? But usually what happens, even if you reach that alignment, it is not always maintained. The Kodak and Sony, those companies died out, and they were market leaders at one point, right? They have to react to situations, how the situation is changing. And the things could change in different levels. Market dynamics, client expectations, technology, competition, anything. So you have to change. So first we were talking about motivating individuals to reaching a particular goal. Now we also have to change them. Right? Is it tough or easy, changing people?
It's very difficult.
I think
it's very difficult.
Difficult, right? Why is it done? Let's come down to. Okay, that's a good question. Some people ask, can people change? Other people say, do they really want to change? Generally, people who have been frustrated with trying to make people change, but it didn't happen, so they get frustrated that these guys do not want to change at all. Right. So let's look at some of the theories about how people think. So there's a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. Anybody heard about that book? Yes? Read that?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So let's look at exercise. I need a volunteer. Two volunteers. One volunteer will just use smartphone to measure time. That's easy job. You want to? You are smart, you ready? Good. Some other people? Some other person? One person.
What do you do?
Alright. No dancing.
Yeah, I
said. So please get up and let me know when your timer is ready. I'll give you a task and then I'll say 1, 2, 3. At the count of 3, you'll start your time. Ready? So the task for you is you have to say A to Z. Right? As fast as possible, but it should be understandable. Right?
Yeah.
Ready? 1, 2, 3.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G, S, I, J, K, L, M, B, Q, R, S, T, U,
R, how
much time?
5.92. Very good. Alright. Next one. Reset your timer, please. Next task. You have to do from Z to A. Ready? Ready? That's fine. Come on, don't underestimate yourself. Ready? 1, 2, 3, start.
Z, Y, X, W, V, U, T, S, R, S, sorry, R, Q, P, T,
O, 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 O,
O,
O. Alright, you can stop. How much time?
21.0.
21.0, and he didn't even go halfway, right? 41 seconds. What happened here?
Change.
Change?
After
what else?
You
know
the
series, right?
You know the series. The way we learned, basically.
The way we learned
something.
He did learn it right? You want to try something else?
We were trying to change the process the way we learned it over a period of time. And we are trying to
change
it from there.
The way he used to behave is actually a bit of a not something usual.
So the thing is, he knows ABCD, and I could see that when he was going the other way around, the backwards, he was trying to calculate, okay, it is OP, so it should be PO. You're doing that calculation, right? Everybody will probably do that. Because the way we memorize these pairs,
yes.
All of us have that pairs in mind, AB, CD, EF, GH, IJ, all that thing. So when you're doing going backwards, that was you're trying to flip the pairs one by one, right? So back to this topic, thinking fast and slow. Thinking fast is our subconscious mind. The subconscious mind works on the basis of patterns. The pattern of ABCD to Z is so very well established in mind. If I wake you up at 3 o'clock in the night and ask you, of course you'll wake me up, but you can easily say A to Z, right? It will not take you that much time. If not 5.92, maybe 7.92. Right? So the pattern is very well established. That is the subconscious mind. Our subconscious mind keeps on creating patterns. And anybody heard about how much time it takes us to create habits? There's two different theories. One says 21 days, if it is a daily activity. The other says 55 to 60 times you have to repeat an action, so it becomes your muscle memory is built on that. Right. So you have to basically repeat a pattern enough number of times. Right. So that's the subconscious mind. Fast processing, pattern-based, hardwired responses, automatic perception is energy efficient. It keeps on creating new patterns. It keeps learning patterns because it saves energy. A to Z, it's so fast. You don't have even to think about that. Right? The subconscious mind, the slow processing mind. When you are going the other way around, the subconscious mind did not have that pattern. So what you're doing, you're calculating. If it's OP, it should be PO. That's conscious mind working. Conscious mind can create new patterns. If you do it enough number of times over maybe the next week, the next time if we have a session, I ask you to do the same exercise, you will do much better. I'm sure if not 5.92, you probably will finish it in 11, 12 seconds. Because you might have created a new pattern. At some point, your conscious mind helps you in that. Right? Ever wondered why dogs bark at beggars and these people? Are they afraid that this guy is so poor that he's going to steal my food or something else? Yeah, they do not match the pattern. They do not match the pattern of normal people. He looks different. So it's an automatic response. Something is different, he'll start barking, right? Dogs bark. If you see an elephant coming to the city, they start barking. We have seen elephants in Discovery. We know what they are. These guys probably have not seen Discovery. So when you see an elephant, it does not match the normal pattern of animals. They start barking, right? That's all different patterns. When you learn driving in the beginning, we might go 20-25 kilometers in 1 hour, right? We are tired in 1 hour. When you're learning driving, because it is so conscious mind is actively involved. All right, brake is this, okay, here is this, right? You're so much involved in that. That's conscious mind working on it. 2 or 3 years later, the patterns have been well established. You might be driving through the same route, taking almost same time, not taking much. We're talking to the guy on the side, just next to us, right? We feel less tired because the subconscious mind has perfected many of those motions. Good?
On another note, when you drive straight, it's always going to be easy, but reverse driving is not that easy. We're not always used to
that's a good point, yeah. Reverse is because the pattern is not that long later, perfected. Good. So can people change? So the reason why people don't want to change is your subconscious mind does not like change. It wants to follow patterns. Your subconscious mind wants to follow patterns. How much time do you have?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. So I'll just quickly wrap up. So I'll just make 3 statements about change. One thing is everybody derives some comfort in the status quo, the way things are, right? Because we are tuned to that way of working, right? If your company, let's say a big company like Cognizant or TCS or Infosys and all, they have lots of buses, right, for people, for transport. And let's say they want to optimize their carrying people. So not everybody has to be carried to the office at the same time. They want to span it out. And they have figured out some ultimate logic that people will be coming not at exactly within half an hour. Maybe they'll come to the office starting from 6 o'clock or say 7 o'clock to 12 o'clock. So they spread out the entire entry into the office. And they have created a super app where they tell you the date for 6 o'clock in the evening, what time you're supposed to report to for the bus to the next morning, right? So on Monday evening, I come to know Tuesday, I have to report that my bus will be coming at 6 o'clock. And the next day, I come to know my bus will be coming at 11 o'clock. Would you like it? Right? It's going to have too much of disruption. So you like a known rhythm to your day. The second thing is everybody likes a little bit of change, right? One quick exercise, one more volunteer. Come on. Right. What is your favorite food? Give me your favorite food combination that you absolutely love.
Curd rice.
Curd rice. Add some more stuff. Curd rice and what?
Pickle.
Okay. Add something more. Pepper.
Yeah.
Okay. Add something more. That's it. Perfect. You love it. All right. What if I give you curd rice with pepper and pickle 7 days a week? Sorry. 3 times a day, 365 days a year.
I'll get bored.
What? That's your favorite food, right?
Yeah. Repeatedly same thing.
Right. So you want a little bit of change.
Yes.
Right. So now, what is the formula? People want to follow a pattern, but they also want to change. So what is the magic formula? How do you figure how much they want to change, and when do they want to change? What is the formula? There should be some method to this madness, right? Sometimes people don't want change, sometimes they won't change.
It depends on the person's behavior, how it's going to be changed. It should not be any specific formula, how much percentage.
It must be empirical.
Process that allows flexibility. So for example, you know you have an 8-to-5 job, but it's not that you're punching in time, you know that's okay today, I have to cover 8 hours and I can do it at this lab as per my convenience today. One example.
Very good point. So the bottom line is people like change when it comes from within. He doesn't want to eat curd rice anymore. It's coming from him. In the other case where the company is telling you what time you need to report, it is coming from outside. So bottom line to understand as a leader, as a manager is people like change when it comes from within. And any ideas how Agile tries to deal with that? Or how Agile tries to use this idea? That people like change and it comes from within?
So to empower the team, so once they empower the team, they are
make them partner in change. Absolutely.
They are more taking as a responsible for making the decision. So once they make
absolutely
the decision,
so Scrum Master is a facilitator. That's the important thing. Scrum Master does not make decisions. He facilitates the decision-making process. So in the end, it is team's decision. If the team has arrived at a decision, they will own that decision. If you go there and say, guys, this is the way you're working, from Monday onwards, let's not do this shit anymore, right? This is what I have experienced, I'll tell you exactly what needs to be done, just follow this. They might end up following that, but they will not feel good about it. Right? So that's a very important, powerful thing. And as a coach also, right, you have to ask people the right question. Asking people the right question is important. You make them think about problem and about solutions. And maybe give them, if you have the solution and your team is stuck, you give them a little bit of hint. Do you think if we try this, this might work? A question like that. And they say, yes, I think it might work. And where can they also do that? And that they will add on to that question, solution layer. Good? Does it make sense? All right, so quick summary. So if you want to go back to those three, two or three things you wrote in the beginning of the session, it's up to you to go back and see if any of these theories help you look at the same situation slightly differently or understand it better, that why that thing happened, why I had this challenging situation with somebody else. All right, thanks a lot, guys. I think I'm done.